everybody. I'd like to get right down to business. Peace, power, prosperity, most of all, love to you and your families. So I'm going to try to make this, hopefully under 30 minutes if I can. Again, to those of you out there who continue to complain, and this is mostly my mother, about how I look, how I appear, how I pronunciate words, whether or not I stutter or nod or say ums or ahs, you're missing the point again. Please pay attention to the message, not the messenger. I don't take any of it personal. I'm having fun. I'm having fun sharing the knowledge, and sharing it and teaching is its own reward. So I don't take it that serious, but I really wish people would really pay attention to what's being said, do their own homework, take full responsibility for their own health, be empowered, and then listen to what's being told to them. I just got through reading an interesting book. A lot of it, the material in the book I was already quite familiar with, but it doesn't hurt to get things reinforced from a purely scientific point of view. And that book was called Wheat Belly by William Davis, so I'll give you a quick overview. Gliadins, exomorphins, alpha amyloid, gluten, glycemic index. And by the way, the glycemic index of wheat, especially once it's processed, is sky high. Glycemic index is your body's sugar response. How quickly does your sugar rise and then fall, and how much of a insulin response does a certain food stuff give you, i.e. sugar up, insulin up, sugar down, and insulin goes down. And this is like a yo-yo. And this is where we do not want our blood sugars. We want our blood sugars to go up naturally, plateau, and then come down slow. When they go sky high, not only are you getting a sugar overload, and ultimately you're going to build up a burnout of your pancreas, i.e. your beta cells in your pancreas that make insulin, they get burned out. They get tired like any other organ. And the end receptors also start to build up its own resistance to the insulin itself, so it becomes less responsive, meaning that you need more insulin to get the same response to drive the glucose in the cell. I've talked about the this in very simple form in the prior videos, but now we're talking about the wheat. We know if we eat at least a 75% raw food diet, that's fruits and vegetables, you can mix it up as your intuition tells you to. Again, healing is an art, and that art means that you're paying attention to your body, you're starting to read your body's signs, the body's cries for hydration and water. You must be in tune with that. The body's cries for fat. You must be in tune with that. If you are not, and that's just one of the last areas I had to really get in tune with, where my body was not paying attention to the need, especially for this brain, for fat, especially long chain and medium chain fatty acids, omega-3 fatty acids. So, the body's in a mix of omega-3, 6s, and 9s, but 6s and 9s, when they're left unchecked by the 3s, are pro-inflammatory. But the body needs a mixture of all of that, including cholesterol. And without having that satiation coming from fat calories, your body, at least my body, will start to crave it from whatever source it can. And when I'm driving to work and I haven't had the proper amount of fat, especially to start the day, I will eventually be tempted to either eat in the hospital cafeteria, which is not the greatest food, or fast food. So I've learned that I don't want to do either of those, so I learned to take care of myself before I ever leave the house. And then, of course, I have my lunch bag with me, where I have fruits, my teas, and water, or a smoothie, to keep me out of trouble. But I found that when I get the proper fat intake, especially the night before and the morning of, I lose all cravings. Wheat, on the other hand, increases your cravings no matter how much of it you eat. Matter of fact, it is a cycle of eating. So go read Wheat Belly by William Davis. One of the things he was saying was that the wheat has a very specific property. Well, first of all, wheat has been genetically altered, and we dare say modified, to where it's a completely different type of a plant than it was, let's say, 2,000 years ago. So ancient wheat versus today's wheat, two completely different things. And why did the wheat change? Well, we genetically modified it, we hybridized it, and we made it so that we could get a high yield, a short amount of time, and keep it as viable as possible until harvest. Unfortunately, in doing that, we've changed the genetic structure. We've played God, and of course, when man plays God, he does so stupidly. Man doesn't play God. Man should express God, not play God. So we've now created a wheat monstrosity where almost, when you look around at processed foods, almost all of it contains wheat. And so on a diet that's 75% fruits and vegetables, that's already 75% where you're never going to even look at wheat. The other 25%, which I tell you to play around with responsibly, you should be getting a certain amount of fats, a certain amount of proteins, a certain amount of carbohydrates, unrefined carbohydrates. I hate when people use the word carbohydrates, because carbohydrates is such a ubiquitous term. So is protein, and so is fat. And so we have to be very clear what we're talking about. And I'll probably do a whole video on the maintenance diet. I talk a lot about the detoxification diet, where you're 100% raw, at least for 90 days, drinking green drinks, making your teas, making your smoothies, eating a preponderance of fruit, since fruit seems to be the most cleansing out of fruits and vegetables. But some of us need less fruit and more the green stuff. It depends on your constitution, your psychology, and your genetics. So again, you have to pay attention to what your body is crying for. And any one day, your body may need the green stuff, it may need the fruits, it may need a combination of two, and you have to be able to eat it responsibly. Once you add wheat to the picture, though, and this thing starts driving your glucose up and down, taking that glycemic index and wreaking havoc on that, and then with these endorphins, which are your natural sort of morphine-like substances you get when you're on a natural high, when you go on a run, you play an exercise, you feel invigorated, it's just a natural high. You're in nature, and meditation can release these substances, and these are substances that are naturally made in the brain. Well, we have exorphins, which are morphine-like substances that are called gliadins, and these chemicals in the food of wheat can act as a morphine-like substance to the brain. And what does that do? It sets up wheat to be an addictive food. Now, you add other chemicals, you add processed sugar to the mix, you add dairy to the mix, etc., because wheat is usually mixed with other things. Again, the high fructose corn syrup is horrible mixed with wheat. Any type of sugar mixed with wheat. In fact, wheat is just a bad food stuff altogether that we should probably go really out of our way to avoid. I mean, it can set up this addictive process, and when you stop wheat, you go through withdrawal. It's just as bad as crack cocaine, or I wouldn't call it exactly bad as a heroin addict coming off of heroin, but you go through some pretty gnarly symptoms. And a lot of us don't realize we're addicted to it. A lot of us don't realize how much wheat is in our diet. If you have cakes, cupcakes, crackers, wheat thins, cereals, even some cereals that say oats, and you look at it, there's wheat added to it. You look at some sauces, there's wheat added to it. You look at soups, there's wheat added to it. All these breads, the sprouted breads, the seven grain breads, all the healthy breads. There's no such thing as a healthy bread when there's wheat in it, because our bodies, again, don't do well with wheat, just like we don't do well with most dairy products. I've always said that you can do some cooking on light heat with either clarified butter or grass-fed non-salted butter. But again, most of the time we're not going to be cooking our food. But for those of us who are still cooking on an everyday basis, use more of that. You'll get in less trouble than cooking with vegetable oils. So getting back to the wheat conundrum, we find that when people, we find that it has a psychological effect. It has an insulin effect. It doesn't provide the body the proper type of fiber that it needs. And it's also being promoted by the food industry as one of the healthy whole grains. And we have this whole thing about healthy whole grains. There are very few healthy whole grains that I would even consider. I've talked about spelt, but we have to be careful. Why? Because spelt has gluten, which is heavily concentrated in wheat. And that's why we have people who are gluten insensitive, developing all kinds of diseases, celiac disease, Crohn's disease, all these inflammatory bowel diseases get lumped into this category. And I wouldn't be surprised if wheat is at the core of a lot of this. It creates a immune response when you eat the wheat, because these proteins are foreign to the body, these the carbohydrates, the sugar response, it just shocks the system. And you can imagine that eating these breads, eating the burger buns, eating the, I don't care if it's organic wheat, it doesn't matter. And see, this is where a lot of us go wrong. Vegetarians go wrong because they think they can get away with eating bread, unleavened bread, and that in the Indian community is still with wheat. So we really, from the research I've been doing, from really just getting away from processed foods altogether, and then knowing that wheat is really something that packs on the belly fat, and I think that's why the title of the book is Wheat Belly. And we know that belly fat is different from fat around other areas of the body. This is called visceral fat, and this belly fat or visceral fat is very active. It produces its own hormones, it has its own receptors, it is active metabolically, it stores toxins, it can excrete toxins, it can excrete estrogen-like compounds. So we do not want to have excess belly fat. So the best measure of maintaining proper weight is your basal metabolic index, your BMI. And for the majority of Americans, we're somewhere between 29, 30, 31, 32. That is overweight to obese. Anything over 30 is obese. You know, it's not uncommon for men to be walking around with 42 waist or and above, and that's not really very healthy, given your height and your BMI, your basal metabolic rate. You can go do some research, and you can Google BMI or start page it, and determine, it's very easy math to determine where you stand and what your you know, where you stand in this category in terms of really a measurement of body fat. But your waist size is extremely important, and wheat just again wreaks havoc and packs on the abdominal body fat. Man boobs, can you say there's a word where, what is it, mastectomy, I can't remember what the medical term was, but it's men who actually begin to get this flabbiness around their chest, gynecomastia, and it's unsightly. If you look at yourself in the mirror, obviously you don't like what you see, so it can affect your self-esteem. And now, on top of all that, it means that you're not healthy. And also, it's part of that whole estrogen overload that I'll be talking about when I do my video on the estrogen Armageddon. Okay, we are already under a toxin Armageddon. Now, I'll start breaking down the specific toxins so we can understand that. So really, the take-home message of the book is that, number one, most grains are bad for you. There are a few, spelt, amaranth, quinoa, a few that you can get away with on occasions, and small wild rice on occasion, small amounts. But we don't, we have to look at, I always say two things. One thing I've said on the video, but another thing that I also tell my patients, so I'll bring it to the YouTube channel. Eat like a gorilla and eat like a caveman. Eat like a hunter-gatherer. I mean, hunter-gatherers did not go and cultivate grains. Now, I'm not saying the cultivation of grains in and of itself is a bad thing. I'm saying what we do now in a mass-produced society to cultivate grains is bad. Most of the hunter and gatherers did not cultivate grain. They got the grains wild. And when they started to cultivate grains, they weren't messing around with hybridization and genetic modification. I don't think they were much aware of the implications of that, and that's probably one of the ways when ignorance is bliss. So sometimes knowledge can be a bad thing if misapplied, especially if misapplied with the bottom line is only profit. And clearly the food industry, the wheat industry, and the medical industry have come together to come up with some crazy thoughts that we shouldn't be eating healthy fats, we shouldn't be eating saturated fats, we shouldn't be eating animal fats, we shouldn't be eating eggs, we should be eating wheat. Whole grains. Healthy whole grains. There are very few healthy whole grains, and wheat is the worst offender out of all of them. Please get wheat out of your diet. Those of you who are gluten insensitive probably know it by now. Sometimes it is subclinical, you don't know it, but everybody is reacting to wheat in their diet. It is something you can do without, especially if you have this belly fat, because this abdominal fat, as I said, is hormonally active, metabolically active, and it is difficult to get rid of if you continue to consume wheat and all the products with wheat. I mean, you can go in a supermarket, and I would dare say 75% of the products in the supermarket contain wheat in some way, shape, or form. And then those other ones have soy, which is genetically modified and has its own problems. Number one being that it has phytates, and number two, it blocks mineral uptake unless it's been fermented, like miso, tempeh, etc., etc. So get rid of wheat from your diet is a very bad thing. And if you're trying to lose weight, and this brings us back to the Weight Loss 101 video, if you're trying to lose weight and you're trying to say, okay, I'm not going to worry about raw food so much right now, I'm not going to stop eating meat right now, but I do want to eliminate a few things from my diet. What should you eliminate? Wheat's probably first on the list, and I don't talk about wheat a whole lot. I just talk about processed carbohydrates. Milk and dairy. Every once in a while, cultured cheese, you might be able to get away with it. Every once in a while, you may be able to get away with some yogurt, but I would just do away with the dairy. Once I did away with dairy, most of my aches and pains in my body went away, I would say within a couple of weeks. But of course now, milk and milk products are combined with wheat. And then they add the third thing I would definitely get rid of is hydrogenated trans fatty acids or vegetable oils that are sitting on a shelf of a store. Would I get rid of olive oil? No. Would I get rid of coconut oil? No. Would I get rid of flaxseed oil? No. Would I get a hemp seed oil? No. I would use those healthy oils in a salad dressing. Would I cook with those oils? Almost never. Because the minute you heat those things up, as I said in previous videos, you are making that fat rancid, and you're taking something that's otherwise healthy for the body and making it unhealthy. So removal of trans fatty acids. Now, the funny thing in most of these wheat, processed wheat products, is that we have all of this in the wheat product. We have the wheat. We have it cooked, we have it processed to the max. Then we take it and we add milk to it. Then we take it and we add the trans fatty acid vegetable oils and put it all together and come up with the processed food. And we add some sugar to it if it's a breakfast cereal. And we call it, you know, healthy whole grains. And it says whole wheat, heart healthy. There's nothing heart healthy about that. That stuff will kill you eventually. Okay, it will lead to cancer. It will lead to inflammation. It will lead to arthritis, rheumatoid arthritis, degenerative arthritis, you name it. It has an acidic load on the body, which we now understand is not a good thing. We want to shift the body more to a base or alkalinized mode, but since the blood pH is 7.4, 7.365 if you want to really get technical. But anyway, a few points of I'm talking about a few hundredths of a point of shifting that blood pH is deadly. And this is what leads to arthritis, because then the body starts to cannibalize the calcium to help in maintaining the alkalinization, the alkalinity of the environment around the cell. Okay, and to neutralize the acids that are coming out. So we're going to have natural acids coming out of our cells as a metabolic process, a natural metabolic process, and then we want to get that naturally gets poured out of your skin through sweat, through the urinary tract, i.e. through your kidneys. Some of it even gets recycled back into the colon. I was counseling a patient the other day, and a coaching client, and invariably most of the people that come to me sick are not having enough bowel movements and eating way too much wheat, trans fatty acids, and milk products. And then they add the eggs to it. But these are not your pasture-raised, free-range, organic eggs. These are the lowest quality eggs. And it's all thrown into these dough products. These patients were having bowel movements once every other day, and they thought they were doing good. And some patients will come to me with once a week bowel movements, but the majority of you will have one bowel movement a day, but the real issue is that's not enough. You need to have two bowel movements, three bowel movements, maybe four bowel movements a day. Now you're doing good. Minimum two bowel movements. If you listen to Jennifer Daniels, MD, she'll tell you need a minimum of three. I just say two to four, depending on what you eat and how many meals you eat. But and that gastric emptying time, i.e. the time you put it in your mouth, it goes down the esophagus, goes into the stomach, gets acidified, then gets into the small intestine with all the pancreatic enzymes, the bile from the liver, etc., the fat emulsification, and going through should all go through within 24 hours. Well, most of us, that's taking 48 hours, 72 hours. It's not enough. So what else can we do to improve health? By giving up wheat, by giving up milk, by giving up these processed foods, but I mean, wheat is a huge offender. So, and I can tell you, a lot of you people that are overweight, wheat is a primary source of your calories, and you're not aware of it. So please wake up, start paying attention to your consumption of wheat. You can go through withdrawal, it can cause insulin resistance. It's probably one of the leading issues in terms of diabetic insulin resistance, syndrome X, which is a metabolic syndrome of insulin resistance. And we also know that insulin going high also leads to what? It's almost an immediate storage of these sugars as fat. Where does the fat go? Right on your abdomen. And this creates a monster all in and of itself. So since we're already under estrogen Armageddon, we do not want to have aromatizing fat that's biologically active, that's making, you know, estrogen-like compounds in our bodies. It is not good for anyone, male or female. So you can go through some research on belly fat, or abdominal fat, and it's metabolic activities. This is a fat of, you know, fat on your cheeks or your neck, on your legs, on your butt is quite different than the fat that's sitting right on your abdomen, right over your liver. It's quite different. So I don't know how many of you are aware of that, that there are differences in fat. So I would definitely pay attention to my waist size and my BMI. Of course, you can pay attention to weight, but remember, weight can be very, very fooling. You can increase your lean muscle mass and gain weight and lose fat. You can increase your hydration and gain weight, or your body starts to hold on to fluids because you become too acid. So it's trying to put out the fires of inflammation, and you can gain weight. Well, you've gained water weight. Either way, any type of weight gain, you need to look at it critically, you know, and two out of the three ways of gaining weight are unhealthy. So what would I do once I stopped wheat? Well, you may want to take a few days off from work, because if you are very sensitive and you have these wheat cravings, you may have to lock yourself up like a drug addict and actually go through a withdrawal of wheat. You must read the ingredients, and you must stay away from processed foods. You must not eat breads. You must not eat cakes. You must not, I mean, I'm talking about never. I'm not talking about, sometimes it's like an alcoholic. When they say they're an alcoholic, that means they never can take a drink again, because one drink can open up the floodgates. And by the way, beer is full of wheat and wheat products, and full of grain and grain products that we shouldn't have. So if you want to go drink some alcohol, you could go drink an organic wine, and not too much of that either. Because we're really looking at, again, managing the microbiome of the gut. Now, there are bacteria all over our bodies, all over our skin. We're in a symbiotic relationship with these bacteria. I mean, most of these bacteria, thank God, out of the majority of species of bacteria that are in us are good bacteria. There are a couple of bad actors in the gut microbiome, and I'm doing a lot of research on the gut microbiome, how to replace it, how to use fermented foods to replace it. Just doing a ton of research. That's where a lot of my attention is going these days, is on the gut microbiome. So we can maintain the gut microbiome, and the first way to maintain it is to stop putting stuff in there that is not conducive to the growth of these healthy bacteria that kill off these bacteria, like antibiotics. And by making sure we're getting enough hydration, by making sure that we're eliminating through feces on a consistent basis, and just through understanding what this tube, especially this tube called the colon is. It's a yogurt factory. It actually takes foodstuffs, throws bacteria at it at body temperature, and creates a substance that's brownish in color, and that comes from the bile. It's brownish in color and full of bacteria. So when you're taking a crap, you're actually letting human yogurt out into the bathroom. It's teeming with bacteria. Now they're doing crazy stuff like fecal transplants, where they're taking the bacteria from feces and put it, I mean, Jesus Christ, can you just stop it? Fecal transplants, no. We can take good flora, we can take fermented foods, we can take supplements, we can take start to understand what feeds the gut, but certainly it is not wheat, it is not processed food, it is not alcohol, it is not antibiotics. These actually have the counter effect. It is not trans fatty acids, and it's typically not milk, although again, there's acidophilus in milk, but remember, acidophilus is just one of the many types of bacteria in the gut. So, I just, again, milk, pro-inflammatory, it increases congestion in the body all over, and it's just not a good substance. But when combined with sugar, especially high fructose corn syrup and wheat, Jesus, you got a real, real recipe for disaster. So managing the microbiome of the gut becomes of primary importance, so you must cut out wheat. Again, 75% raw foods, 25% we can play with, but we must play with it responsibly. And I'm going to again do a video, probably 15 to 20 minute video, it may be a little bit longer, on what should be the maintenance diet, because we don't get a lot of talk about maintenance diet. And very few of us can do like a damn McDonald's. I eat a life regenerated and do 100% raw. A very small segment of the population can get away with that and do it correctly and do it in a healthful way and live a lifestyle that's conducive to raw foods. The hunter-gatherer did eat some meat to eat. They did have cooked foods, but of course there were no chemicals there. The air was clean. The land was clean. They were outside most of the time. They got the vitamin D. They were very social and had to be supportive of each other, because if they weren't supportive of each other, they would die. They ate meat rarely, and they fasted because they had to fast. Not because they wanted to fast, but there would be times when there just wasn't food available. So they would naturally fast, and we can mimic that by fasting one day a week, or one day every 2 weeks, or a couple of days a month, to mimic that, because I think that has a good way of setting your base metabolism. And base metabolism is the rate of calories you burn at rest. So it's important that we, again, eat like gorillas and eat like these hunter-gatherers did, because, again, meat came, it was clean, it was wild, it was gamey, it wasn't a whole lot of it available. They cooked it, they ate it then, they didn't keep it for days and days and days, and their diets were such that the gastric emptying and digestive time between mouth to anus and excretion was very short because of the diet. And likely they did pay attention to what they were eating and how much they ate, and they stopped eating when they were full. When grains got brought into society, we were able to stop being hunter and gatherers, so there was some positivity to grains, and grains did feed a lot of starving nations, or so they say. Again, the grains that we started with even 30, 40, 50 years ago, much less thousands of years ago, especially wheat, is not the same. So go do the research on einkorn grains, especially wheat, because that's an ancient grain, which is likely much safer to eat. And it's a form of wheat, but much safer to eat than the wheat that we get today, that's ubiquitous and now all over the world. So, is there anything else I wanted? Oh, and then, of course, we want to always focus on hormonal management. Okay, now the 12 elements of health, I'll go through them again. And this is not in any particular order of importance. Light, sunlight, love. We have to have the ultimate human emotion and the ultimate force in the universe flowing through us. Laughter, which is our own way of maintaining positive energy, having fun in life. Laughter means that you're having fun in life. And we always have to look forward to having fun every single day. And most of the people that come to me as a neuropsychiatrist when they come in for mental health reasons are not having fun. I had a lady who everybody in her family said, well, she's depressed. We don't know why she was depressed. She was Hispanic. She was Spanish speaking only. Luckily, I do habla español poquito. That means I speak Spanish a little bit, but I did have an interpreter there. And listening to her story, she was married, never divorced, same man, had three kids of her own. Those three kids had babies. All the grandkids, the three kids of her own, were all living in the same household, and she had become a de facto slave in her own house, not having any fun. Cooking, cleaning, washing, taking care of babies, babysitting, no life for herself. Folks, it's wonderful to be family oriented, but sometimes you can take it to the extreme. So I told her, I said, who are you? Why are you here? What is your purpose? And obviously, your purpose is not to be a slave to your family. You're going to have to learn how to set limits. And boy, once I gave her that information, setting limits for herself, giving her permission to have fun, Matter of fact, telling you, it is mandatory that you have fun. It is one of the 12 elements of health. She took off and no more problems because she was able to set limits with the family. So the family was then able to be educated that, hey, mom and grandma is not your slave. Okay, she needs as much help and support as everybody else, but yet she's the one that's always giving, and never receiving. So it was just an unbalanced relationship and a very dysfunctional family dynamic, of which unfortunately she almost in a way volunteered for. But when you volunteer for something, you can unvolunteer for it. So that's laughter. And then we have, I like to call it the HEG, hydration, emotional poise, grounding. Obviously hydration, fruits, vegetables, water, some of your teas. Emotional poise, meaning you, because you understand who you are, you're not so caught up into the game every day, you can take a step back. And while everybody else is losing their mind, going crazy, going nuts, losing their selves in this emotional reactivity, the self-created drama, okay, or feeding off the drama of others and creating more drama, and then burning up your vital emotional energy, which should be saved and utilized for healing, for regeneration. And so if you're constantly being popped and popped and popped with this emotional outburst after emotional outburst, the ups and the downs and the lefts and the rights, that is a prescription for early termination from the planet. So, grounding. That is when you are barefoot out in the grass, out on the beach, out in the water, touching a tree, whatever it is that gets you reconnected to, get you outside barefoot and reconnected to the earth. There's a cycle that the brain goes through and the whole body goes through where it actually looks for this grounding. And obviously every minute and a half it's looking for this grounding and it doesn't get it. And years and years and years and years of not being grounded is not a good thing. So I say at least ground yourself once or twice a day. You can do that when you're getting sunlight, right? Because you're going to get at least somewhere between 20 and 30 minutes of direct sunlight a day. Some of you who are darker skin need more. Some of you who are lighter skin, a little bit less. You figure out what it is that you need. But eventually, I would say most of us need about an average of 15 minutes on each side of our bodies, which is as much exposure as we can get. So that's HEG, H-E-D. So we did LLL, H-E-G, DOA, detoxification, oxygenation, alkalinization, self-explanatory, and extremely important that we pay attention to the hydration part of the HEG. So these are your elements of health. You want to nutrify yourself with, again, mostly raw foods, high density, low calorie foods. And then you want to be able to supplement with natural food supplements. I won't go into it because I went to it in the last video with the sea supplements, with the herbs, with some of the herbs from South America, with the camel, et cetera, and so there's no need to repeat that again, but these herbs can be put into smoothies, these supplements, which are natural food supplements in and of themselves, can be put into your smoothies to create the super smoothie, which is how you get your how you take your supplements. I don't take ascorbic acid. I don't take vitamin E. I don't take vitamin isolates. They're toxic and they're not healthy. So there may be a occasional reason why I might recommend a high quality like a coenzyme Q10 for someone who's got heart disease. Some essential fatty acids you can take as a supplement, provided that it's a high quality supplement. And usually I will recommend krill oil for you vegetarians out there. You don't want krill oil, so you can take one of the other vegetable derived oils like flaxseed oil. But this is a very important concept. So just make sure that you're following the 12 elements of health on a consistent basis, and it's always in the back of your mind. Because when you're doing that, you are naturally staying away from wheat. You're naturally staying away from processed food. You're naturally normalizing your weight. You're naturally getting anti-cancer substances in your body. You're naturally getting rid of waste products. You're naturally managing your hormones. You're naturally getting your glands toned up and ready to go. So hormonal management, which is, you know, I say pay attention to the insulin management if you want to, because that then manages all the other hormones. Even though we know the pituitary is the master gland, of course we want that tissue to be functioning well. But I just say pay attention to glycemic index, pay attention to insulin, and you'll find that you'll be a lot healthier because it tends to help out all the hormones, thyroid hormones, sexual hormones, estrogens, the good estrogens, the testosterone, the good testosterone, and the pituitary, thyroid, the parathyroid. All these things have to be working in harmony and concert together. So I think that I've made my point against wheat. I've reiterated again the 12 elements of health. And did I leave anything else? I think I might have left something out. And if I did, I'll list it on the exiting credits from here. The thing is not to be trying to think things through in a linear fashion. Eventually you're going to trust your intuition on a daily basis to guide you, but right now we have to get rid of stuff. We have to clean out the body. We have to hydrate. We have to alkalinize. We have to nutrify the body properly. We have to get rid of the toxic thinking and this constant emotional stress. I'm going to leave this video today. Governor Brown signed in legislation that will force parents to inoculate their children, which I find quite distasteful. I find not un-American. I don't find it, but am I surprised? No, because big money is behind it. I find it very strange that that people are worried about kids who have not been inoculated causing an outbreak of measles and smallpox and all kinds of other things. To the kids that have been inoculated, and I said, well, the kids that have been inoculated, shouldn't they be protected so they wouldn't be worried about? That's the reason you get vaccinated, but no, vaccines are a source of toxins as well, and I'll talk about vaccines at another time. This is not the video for that, but today was a landmark decision where, again, Americans, you think it's just the state of California, this is now the third state that doesn't allow you to opt out, and this will be spreading like wildfires throughout the entire United States. So whether you're pro vaccines or you don't like vaccines, or you're like, hey, I need to wait and get more information, your choice has been taken away as far as your children are concerned. And everybody should be extremely, extremely disappointed in the California legislator. Everybody should be extremely, extremely disappointed that you don't have the right to choose. And more we see our freedoms being eroded by the dark forces. We can call the big corporations. It's beyond that, because we've got to understand the big picture here of population control and money and power. But I believe that population control is now in full effect. Put the pieces of the puzzle together and you shall see what I mean. So with that, I'm going to sign off. There's a lot more to talk about, and there's even more elements of health I can get into right now. Pay attention to hormonal management. Pay attention to the gut microbiome, i.e. your good bacteria, the good flora in your gut. Do as much studying as you can on those two subjects. Again, the 12 elements of health kind of automatically address all of this stuff naturally. Eat more fermented foods. Take well-researched probiotics, and I'll have a list of my top three probiotics. Sauerkraut is all right, as long as it's made with live cultured bacteria and not with vinegar. If you do use vinegar, use apple cider vinegar. I like Bragg's with the mother, and I'll use it in salad dressing. Sometimes I'll take a sip of it and drink water down right away. Find that it's really good for digestion. And it's just a lot of little tricks we can do to get our bodies back in shape again. If you find yourself bloated with a lot of gas, you know that you either have the wrong food in your system and your body's not breaking it down and it's starting to ferment and create gas, or you have the wrong food combination together. And I'll talk about food combinations again. I've talked about it before, but now that I have most of the foundation videos out, I can, you know, talk, pick and choose in short subjects, you know, 15-minute, 10-minute talks on the 15-minute talk on vaccines, a 15, 20-minute talk on the maintenance diet. So, but you've got to get the foundation first, the 12 elements of health. And so with that, I'm going to sign off. Peace, power, prosperity, and most of all, love to you and your loved ones. Don't let any decision by the government, any decision by anybody affect who you are, what you are. Stay true to yourself. Stay on the path. Things will work themselves out as long as you stay focused and confident. Do not allow fear to run your life. Bye now.